I would like to welcome everyone to the New York Alternative Investment Roundtable's latest forum, Impact Investing in Africa. I am Vijay Belloc. I chair the Roundtable Forum Committee, and we're glad you're here this afternoon with us. But before we get started, I'd like to take a moment to thank our sponsors. Britt, if you'd put up the sponsor screen, thank you. So our sponsors, as always, we're hopeful that they're very active, and they are usually. And actually today, one of our speakers is from one of our sponsors, which you'll see later. So our sponsors are Alston Bird, Baker Tilly, Bloomberg, Deloitte, Grant Thornton, New Mountain Capital. And our nonprofit sponsors are the CAIA Association, the Grand Duchy of Luxembourg, and the British Department for International Trade. And all our sponsors come from within the industry, and we're very thankful to have them. Before we get started, I want to just take a minute for logistical issues. We're running today's session as a webinar. It's being recorded. That means that you cannot speak or see other attendees. That way we don't interrupt the panelists, but you can use the chat function at the bottom of your screen and or the Q&A to ask questions, and our moderator will monitor that the whole time. So without further ado, today we're excited to welcome a panel of experts in Africa who are going to share their thoughts regarding the most promising sectors and opportunities that exist when it comes to investing in the world's second most populous continent behind Asia. We have from the Department of International Trade, as I mentioned, Tracy Austin. She's Financial and Professional Services Director in Africa for the UK Department for International Trade, and is a dual British South African citizen. She has more than 20 years of direct experience and fund investment experience specializing in emerging markets, especially in Africa, and has worked across the financial spectrum. In addition to her finance experience, she is a natural resources investment expert and has run large gas portfolios in North Africa. She's managed distressed gold mines in Australia and Colombia and financed numerous junior mines across Africa. And then we have Tawana Muchatatu, hopefully I'm saying that right, with Africa Growth, a division of Knickerbocker Financial Group, which seeks to establish and curate high quality origination in sectors of sustainability, fintech, energy, and agritech on the African continent. Tawana is also COO at Glitch Finance, a startup blockchain project designing a host of DeFi specific solutions for real world applications, and a project consultant through toptal.com. Throughout his career, he has spent significant time in both fintech and large scale manufacture of fast moving consumer goods in England, Zimbabwe, Singapore, and Malaysia. And then we have Rue Nyamboya. She's a sector manager within client coverage at Standard Bank, where she manages a portfolio of clients based in North America who are doing business in Africa. She is also a member of the board of directors of Education Matters Africa Foundation, a nonprofit whose mission is to match underserved talent in Africa with opportunity and development through a generation of dynamic young leaders who are consistently committed to using their education to address challenges in their communities. And today's moderator, our very own Dr. David McLean, serves on the board of directors of, or served on the board of directors of Impact at Africa, a relatively new Pan-African investment ecosystem development network, which seeks to bring together all the ecosystem players. Through his involvement with Impact at Africa, Dr. McLean has provided advice on governance and growth, as well as climate change in Africa, and has led multiple high-profile events within Africa. His most recent book, Understanding and Combating Global Corruption, A Reader, examines the problem of corruption in Nigeria and other countries, including suggestions for addressing it. So without further ado, I'll turn that over to David. Thank you, David.
Yeah, well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm delighted to be doing this panel today. I've done a few panels on African investment, especially impact investing in Africa. So since we have three really, really experienced panelists on, I'm going to stay out of the way and ask questions quickly and let them do their thing. So the first question has to do with impact investing itself. Many people don't know what it is still. So I'd like to ask Rue to kick that off with a response. What is impact investing? How does it work? And how does it differ from, I guess you can say, ordinary sort of capital asset pricing model type investing considerations? So Rue, do you want to start?
Yes, thank you, David. It's such an honor to be here today. Good afternoon, everybody. So I guess the term impact investing has been used interchangeably with a lot of other terms amongst, you know, if you look at a lot of us, we use the term impact investing, responsible investing, socially responsible investing, sustainable investing, ESG. It's all this bucket of terms that we're using to mean sort of the same thing. But according to the Global Impact Investing Network, right, which maybe let's start from there and people can progress from there. According to the Global Impact Investing Network, the actual definition of impact investing is investing with the intent to generate financial return, as well as positive outcomes on environmental and social objectives. Now, I think the key here is that one, there needs to be some intentionality, especially on the environmental and social aspects from the investor to say that they do want to contribute to those outcomes. There is a need for measurement to actually be measuring the outcomes regularly. And then the last piece would just be that it is asset class agnostic. So essentially, you know, any asset class, it could be in equities, fixed income, alternative investments, any asset class does fit the impact investing definition. And then from an Africa perspective, I guess the one last piece I'll just add is that some of the key investors that you see in Africa from an impact investing perspective are like Bamboo Capital. I think Leapfrog has been one of the major investors in this space that's just celebrated their 15th year and seems to be doing quite well. And we can talk about some of the areas they've been investing in later.
So just to follow up on that, and anyone else, any of the other panelists can jump in. It's not all going to be all on you, Rue. With respect to the notion of intentionality, there are people who would argue that with respect to impact investing, any investment is going to have spillover effects that are positive in the areas that impact investors seek to make positive change. So how do you address that, I wouldn't say criticism, or that question? Why is intentionality so important here? Uh-oh. Tracy? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I was gonna pass it on to Tracy since she's the expert here, but...
go ahead, Tracy, jump in.
But love that. What we say as a hospital pass. I'll give my point of view. I just want to say to everybody that's listening, please remember everybody has a lot of bias. So my bias is influenced largely from, I moved from funds to directs, worked a bit with institutionals, and now I'm working with British business. So you can clearly see where my bias is coming from. I'd say the key issue around intentionality is really around something Rue touched on is outcomes. I think outcomes are being linked more and more to performance triggers. So I think you can't really determine what the performance trigger is if there's no outcome. So I think that's a big shift. I'd say actually probably everything that we've seen around negative screening, ESG, actually we've probably come a lot closer to a more encompassing sustainable definition. So it's not really just the impact on its own. But for me, the biggest differentiator, and I see this as a consumer, is that if you look at the drivers of behaviors, company behaviors, saving behaviors, millennials, Gen Zs, of which I'm not one, but I can tell you they really care about these things and they are forcing changes in investment and business models. And I think something which we'll come to a little later is probably the third dimension, which I think intentionality forces, is this issue around disruption, where we are creating solutions through investment strategies that are actually solving problems. So I think we've moved away in some ways, and certainly definitely in Africa, we've moved away from theoretical puritanical applications, which was fair enough where we started probably 10, 15 years ago, But I think we've moved to really, we want to see robust, concrete outcomes that are actually tangible delivery. That would be my take on the intentionality incorporation.
Mm-hmm. Tawana, did you want to add something? You don't have to, but.
No, I think it's been covered completely. So I've got nothing to add there specifically.
Okay. Now, so there's a mechanical question. So people talk about impact investing, and then the question, whether it's in Africa or Latin America or anywhere else, the question comes up, how does one actually do it? What are the mechanics? Maybe I should ask, Tawana, you can take this one if you'd like. What are the mechanics of actually doing an impact investment in Africa? And you can feel free to talk about specific country experience in that regard. So you want to take that, Tawana?
Sure, I can start off. I think to Tracy's point, given my background in the sector I'm working is VC, so we're smaller companies and startups that are trying to do impact within the space around the sectors that we're interested in. So the ways that, and in that way, there's a specific channel in order to get involved in that from an investor's perspective. I think there's a lot of opportunities at different levels and different types of vehicles. I mean, there's sovereign wealth funds, DFIs, and you've got a even smaller charity type organizations. Specifically, the one I'm familiar with is Energy for Impact, based out of Kenya. And they're a registered charity in out of the UK. And they're doing something really specific around energy and the health, agricultural, and businesses at providing sustainable energy and access. And they're doing that through impact. It's in the name, right? Energy for Impact. So there is through donations, and they have different sources for the donations, and they raise regularly. And then from us, from our perspective, for example, at KFG, you can invest directly through us. And there's a combination of things we use from SPV, so special purpose vehicles, as well as raising for specific transactions. And for example, we've seen an opportunity recently in Zimbabwe where a solar company which works and has a 10-year record working with NGOs doing stuff for UNICEF and the UN and health focused projects and schools and charities, and all they need is a debt financing. So that's a different approach, but it's a lower ticket size. We're talking 100K to maximum a million. So there's a lot of examples in there, and I'm sure there's a lot more on the institutional side for larger ticket sizes as well.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else? In terms of the mechanics?
I'll just pop in here and say, I mean, other than obviously the direct route, which I think has been touched on already, I would say that the tech, the availability of capital has certainly liberalized the more direct way of investing in that sense. I think obviously the fund routes remains really popular. We've had the likes of the CDC or the British Investment International, as I think they're going to be known soon. They've anchored a lot of private equity type funds who've gone on to do this. And then where I think there are probably two interesting contributions to add is that we are definitely looking at larger ticket sizes and scale and efficiency. And I think that's something where we've had a lot of pushback around cost of investing in Africa. Plus, of course, we know we're in, you know, weaker trajectories from currency perspective. So we're looking at a return conversation all the time. I think when we talk about our institutionals who are very increasingly, again, through various reasons and pressures, focused on impact in Africa, we are looking at larger sizes, which manifest in the form of big infrastructure, climate-related, renewable-related energy infrastructure. But the other point that I think is really important to talk about is the contribution and the participation through non-direct investing mechanisms. So in other words, technical assistance, capacity building, incubators, accelerators, because we are dealing with ecosystems that are rather underdeveloped or that have very specific needs. And I would almost certainly say that it's very unusual that you would invest in a particular type of impact investment, regardless of the instrument you use, without considering the ecosystem. So I think that's something really important to bear in mind when thinking about the mechanism. I'll leave it over to you, Roo, if you want to add to that.
I think that last point you made, Tracy, I'll just add, say, from a Standard Bank Group perspective, right? If you think about the role that commercial banks played in Africa around SMEs, back in the day, it was just you finance an SME. And I've seen the evolution, at least within Standard Bank and all the banks really, where there is more emphasis now being placed on, it's not just about providing finance, it's ensuring that the ecosystem around the entrepreneurs makes sense, right? The technical assistance is really important. So for example, Standard Bank is partnering now with the likes of Founders Factory in Africa to help build capacity around entrepreneurs in the fintech space and other sectors, really. We have incubators in the bank in all the markets that we're in, which is 20 markets on the African continent. So we have our own incubators now. And one of the main reasons for that is really to help provide that mentorship that SMEs and young entrepreneurs need, and other technical assistance, access to an ecosystem, which really is key to help drive the outcomes that we need from an impact perspective.
There are a lot of incubators and accelerator programs across the continent. My brief experience at Impact at Africa exposed me to how many there are. How do they work out? I mean, are most of them effective? How are most of them funded? What keeps them going? Because it seems that there's a real need to, if you're going to develop the ecosystem in Africa for impact investing, you need accelerator incubator programs. So you want to discuss some of the better ones that you think that you see working well across the continent? And you might say, you might explain what an incubator and accelerator, what those are for those that don't know. Tracy, do you want to take that one?
I was actually asked Tawana to answer that question, because I'm actually probably going to be slightly controversial and say that I actually think that they're less effective, and the scenarios of finding where they're effective. Mm-hmm. But perhaps if we go through, and I think you've lived it more than me, so perhaps Tawana, not to hand it back to you on that basis, but I think you have some more direct experience of living through some of this, and then I can certainly add to that.
Yeah, sure. And thanks, Tracy. And when you're in the VC space and startups, and you're going to come across quite a few of these incubators and accelerators. And I think they come in different formats, and they've got different agreements. You've got the Y Combinators. You've even got a lot of smaller ones that are coming up, and very country-specific ones as well. Mm-hmm. And so exposure just to having conversations with different people and different startups from our deal flow, you get to hear and understand the differences. And I think coming back to the earlier point about when we defined impact investing, that alignment aspect is very important, because mm-hmm. they are essentially become principal, the first investors within whatever comes through that, depending on the structure. Some actually take existing startups, but some actually create startups within that actual flow. So they're quite diverse and range in terms of sizes and sources of funds. So what I think would be add value specifically for this topic is the understanding their relationship towards impact. And it's really going to come down to that earlier point, that alignment between the source of the capital and what that the incumbents of that team or startup or whatever graduates from that program is trying to achieve. This really comes down to that. And to Trace's point, I haven't seen any incubator specifically trying to do that. At least that's come through my desk that I've looked at closely. So there's been a lot in the tech space, and they're looking for tech, and it'll be an outcome of the work that they're doing. They happen to have an impact. For example, if you're making payments or making it easier to take loans, you have an impact, or providing jobs because to small businesses, people who work from day to day earning the equivalent of $2 to $5, and they now have an application that allows us to take a loan or to be able to pay on credit for certain things they use within their businesses. That happens to have an impact because they were solving a very specific problem, sorry. But it's the intention wasn't specifically that to begin with for the program or the accelerator. So that's probably where the gap is. That's my opinion.
Okay, but Tracy, I think being controversial for a few seconds anyway, is not a bad thing.
I feel like my points slightly diminished.
Can we define incubator and accelerator for those that don't know what those are?
Well, I think just as the name suggests, I mean, obviously, I think the beginning part is how do we have a place that generally supports the resources, a kind of a platform, a coming together where we can try and incubate or make it easier for founders to come together in some shape or form. And then obviously the accelerator is usually the scale conversation, and it's usually how do you start to go beyond friends and family and, you know, all the places that you go to first. So I think that that's that natural progression when we think about fundraising.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I think we touched on, Sawana touched on the word gap. I think that's the biggest flaw that I see is the, there's often a gap between the different stages and then what comes after an accelerator. You know, I think it's improved in the last 5 or so years. It's gotten better where you find the incubation acceleration, and maybe the Founders Factory is a good example, closer to the investment process. Whereas previously I've seen these mechanisms set up where they are 3-year funded, they're usually from a philanthropic or a donor, and they are, run their course and then what? And then it's very difficult for those enterprises, whatever stage they're at, to then go on and find funding. And mm-hmm. invariably the leaders or the actors who are running these mechanisms have moved on to something else. So I think there's a misalignment of incentives. But I would strongly advocate that if there's no connection to the value chain of fundraising, that invariably these are just going to be one-off siloed activities that aren't actually going to ultimately achieve scale and bring about this impact that we're talking about. And bringing that impact narrative in is incredibly important because, I mean, I can only imagine when you're trying to struggle for survival and you're trying to do a startup, you know, the last thing you're thinking about is how you're ticking your impact boxes and evidencing it. But that's somehow got to be part of the conversation. So I think it's a combination of those factors. But I have had VC funds off the record turn around and say, you know, we just don't take a lot of, and this is a while ago, a good 3 years ago, but they just said in Africa, they just don't take a lot of, you know, graduates from these kind of programs just because they just aren't yet ready. And they're not the kind of investments that they want to see. These are kind of VC funds. So I'm hopeful that we will narrow that gap, and it is getting there. But mm-hmm. I'm still slightly thinking that a lot of these mechanisms, unless they link to a fund or another part of the value chain of fundraising, they're done in isolation. And I query the data that shows that they're as effective as they could be or should be.
Mm-hmm. Rue, did you want to contribute something on that?
Nothing okay. else to add, David.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you. Thanks for that, Tracy. That was very candid and useful. So let's talk about some case studies. That's always fun, and it's always useful for people to hear about actual case studies. What's worked with respect to impact investing investments? I mean, what are some very good case studies that people can look to see that actually intentional investing in the impact space actually works? So who'd like to take that one? To start off,
yeah, I'll kick it off.
Sure,
if that's all right, David. Thanks.
Yep.
And I think I've mentioned a couple of names already, and I'm really fond of renewable energy ideas and models and organizations. So, and the reason why is just because of access and what that does, especially affordability, as well as just being able to make that into the consistency of access, so it affects the way businesses run and they generate income and therefore having an impact within those communities, especially in remote locations. Okay, so Energy for Impact does that quite directly, and they do that in a number of countries, Tanzania, Kenya, as I mentioned, and they're growing in Benin now and some other countries. And they partner really with a lot of other funds and companies and organizations in order to do that as effectively as possible. You've got, so that's a really specific example because they focus on renewable energy and access. And I think another example that I was, is through debt financing, and that's through just the provision of a company, and this is a direct example, which was financing the conversion of motorcycles or motorbikes into a battery and chargeable solar charger recharging. So these are cleaner and they have these, the environmental aspect is impacted. But not only that, there's a difference between how long they can run for. So the information we had when having a conversation with this particular business and the investors within this company was that they were able to run for longer on a much cheaper charge, a cleaner, less noisy motorcycle, and they were able to do their deliveries and transport very well. So this was between Rwanda and Kenya, and at a lower cost, because the reason why they couldn't do that before was they were viewed as being risky credit to give them credit. They wouldn't pay it back. But the understanding them as users of this, the motorcycle, and the businesses that they were running, which is just them transporting either an individual or product or a parcel, is that they were, you know, very conscientious about getting the job done and living day to day so that they can make the money to feed their family and themselves, right? So they were really reliable and actually lower risk than they were perceived to be. And that had an impact, and it's growing, not only on the environmental side, but also on the social side.
Yeah, and there's a huge need for logistical organization, logistical businesses like that across Africa. I'm not going to mention the names of any large outfits or large companies that are actually trying to develop sort of retail ecosystem across the continent. But that logistics issue is huge right now. And the fact that you're focusing on, you gave a case about sustainable logistics is really interesting. I personally have a focus on that and with respect to the environment and climate issues in Africa, but I'm supposed to stay out of this. So let's, anyone else want to discuss particular cases?
So just to add to, not to harp on the renewable energy piece, but it really is an important one. And I was listening to our chief economist the other day, and he made a comment about the power shortages in South Africa have been contributing a 1% decline to the country's GDP every year for the last 3 to 5 years. Now, this is South Africa that we, from an Africa perspective, right, it's the grid in South Africa is actually better relative to some of the other countries on the continent. So the impact of power on the continent and having access to finance infrastructure like energy, in this case, renewable energy, because of the other parts of impact, is actually quite key. And for us, from a Standard Bank perspective, one of the most recent case studies actually is, if you look at East Africa, and I guess we're going back to East Africa, is the emergence of solar home system companies, right? Where back in the day, people in rural Africa were using kerosene lamps, and there's a health piece to that that is also not good. And the emergence of solar home system companies has actually helped bring cleaner power, right, to communities in Kenya. And so from the financing aspect, I think one of the ways that in thinking of the community that we have on this call, which I'm assuming it's mostly fund managers, right, one of the ways in which you're seeing fund managers participate in this space is they invest in a company like Greenlight Planet. And Greenlight Planet is one of the solar home system companies that is in Kenya right now, but growing into other markets. And banks and DFIs are also coming in. So most recently, Standard Bank, together with Citi, CDC, and I think it's FMO, raised $75 million worth of debt financing for Greenlight Planet in Kenya to help it grow. And the impact there, speaking of measurement, right, was focused on the number of individuals that were going to be supported by this investment. So having more people have access to clean power, which is going to be one of the key things. And then from a Greenlight Planet team, one of the items actually that the investors in this particular deal wanted was a focus on a balanced team from a gender perspective on the investee Greenlight Planet. So the investors are dictating like what some of these positive social and environmental outcomes should be in the investments that they're making.
Tracy?
Yeah, I probably want to take a fund example, and it's hard to define success because you need time to look at something. But I worked with a fund back in 2014, Novastar Ventures, who's now gone on to raise a second fund successfully. But there are a couple of things, and I'll digress slightly from the renewable energy play for a minute, that I think from an investor fund perspective, and I'm going to sort of be a little pat myself on the back here because we were very instrumental in the beginning. But the things that I think were done correctly is that although it was an impact fund with a very clear, it was taking CDC, it was then known as DFID, which as we know is now the FCDO, but it was really taking UK taxpayer money and it was using that as part of its impact mandate. And what they did very consistently was define the impact mandate, and they got all of their initial investors to agree around that. So in other words, they didn't have 10 different reporting requirements from 10 different investors, and had some bitty investors in the beginning. So that was quite a challenge. Second of all, they didn't compromise on the quality and structure, and what they tweaked the fund model, they tweaked what they needed to, but ultimately it's a commercial return generating with a hurdle rate, and the carry incentive is there. But for me, I think one of the most distinguished differences was that they invested in local talent, local Kenyans, local Ugandans, Rwandans. The regional play that they covered was initially East Africa. And they really actually used people on the ground who knew their markets, who could speak local languages. And then they built in the gender dimension. And I think what they've really done well is they've obviously, that recipe worked. A lot of their first-time LPs stuck with them. And I haven't obviously worked on the second fund, but they've jumped the continent, they've moved on to West Africa. And they haven't said, let's try and take an East African fit and put it into West Africa. Because as an African, the homogenization of the continent, I think, is a real problem. We mm-hmm. tend to overly simplify how markets might be the same. And we know that that's the least true thing. So I would say that in that sense, they've managed pilots in a real way using the real key components of investing, but they've overlaid the impact notion and they've managed to use it relative. But I think from what I really loved about the two founders is they never invested in things that they thought were nice to have or things that investors think should have. They invested in things that they believed their recipients in their markets and the customers of the investees needed and wanted from an African perspective. So the validity of need was always very much part of the investment thesis. And I mean, who knows where they'll go, but for me, that's a really positive example.
Yeah, the surest way to waste any investment money is not focusing on the need of the people receiving the funds, rather, you know, whether it's greenwashing or whatever you want to call it. So that's really important. Got a couple of questions that just came in. So let me give these to you now. Are there research institutions that you would particularly recommend for cooperation in green areas? Coming from a macro background, my experience is that they tend to come a nonprofit or consumer software frame, or with a nonprofit or consumer software frame, which is crowded and not generally scalable. If you can hold these two questions in mind at the same time. The second question is, although there are commendable examples, but tech related to energy, land, and water management is much more interesting. That's a comment, not a question really, but you can address that if you'd like. Anyone?
So if I understood the first question, which is speaking to research, right?
Are there research institutions that you would recommend for green areas?
Okay. So, well, not to toot our own horn, but I would actually recommend Standard Bank. but in all seriousness, I do think our banks in Africa do actually do a good job, especially if you think about Africa as a resource-rich continent. We have decades of history around green energy, for example, or energy in general. So I do think that Standard Bank does have a couple of research, a few research reports around the green areas. We do partner with our clients to provide, this is part of what we do on a day-to-day basis, right? You have clients on the continent who are trying to understand the trends, what's going on in different markets, interactions with the governments and different stakeholders, and that's part of what we do. So I do think that the banks are a good place to start, as well as some of the consulting firms. We've certainly worked with some of the consulting firms on the continent mm-hmm. that have done quite a bit of work in this space.
Okay. I was going to say Tracy is a good person to partner with.
Too many to mention, but I would say, obviously, you know, I could punt the Green Finance Institution. There's numerous ones, but I would say the general advice I would say with the consultant you're going to be working with or the research you're going to be relying on has to know the continent and has to somehow have access and connection and real understanding of the country. And I'm going to stop the Africa homogenization for a minute, because that is super important. So if we look at, you know, the green agenda in a place like South Africa, which Rue would know, is very much around just transition, where people are resistant, you know, at a micro level because they fear for job losses. So I think when you've really got to look at it in a very unique place, but there are multiple. So I start with the usual suspects, but I would just ascertain with a lens, you know, where do they really know these markets? Have they really been there? Do they have local teams? How are they working with local government? Those are the kinds of questions that I would be asking when I looked at the research.
Okay.
Yeah, and I would definitely support that, just to add, and really emphasizing on that point about the diversity within the continent. I mean, we've got over 2,100 languages and over 50 countries. And within each of those countries, lots of different tribes and cultures. And understanding that is really important. So localization and those key partners. And we take that framework really seriously with subject matter experts across the different continents, regions, and also with country-specific transactions and making sure we're partnering with the right person. So yeah, it really comes down to where you focus, what are you trying to look at, and then identifying from that who the right person is to partner with.
Yeah, I think that's important from my, again, limited experiences. The homogenization issue is a real problem. Even the notion, you know, sometimes people refer to the continent as a country, and it's certainly not. It's much more diverse and difficult sometimes to penetrate if you don't really have people on the ground that can help. One of the things I wanted to mention while we're moving fast through the time here, and this could go on for a long time, is what's been called the gender lens focus for impact investing. Gender diversity issues are sort of on the front burner now across the continent. So would anyone like to speak to impact investing with respect to addressing gender disparities in terms of access to capital, access to particular roles and jobs, et cetera, across the continent? Rue, would you like to jump in on that? Or?
Sure. So maybe I'll start with a couple of stats. From a gender perspective, looking at private equity investments, 6% of private equity, 6% of investing from private equity is going to women-led or women-owned businesses. And yet about 30-40% of businesses on the continent are women or women-led or women-owned. The other stat that we've been working with is that from a fund management perspective, 5% of capital that is going into funds is only going to women-owned funds. So there is clearly a gap on supporting women who are either women-owned businesses or women that are allocating capital. And the belief, right, and there is some research around this, is that when women are making some of the decisions around allocation of capital, they are positive outcomes generally in the types of businesses that they're going to invest in and the success and performance of those businesses. So in 2018-19, the UNECA, United Nations Economic Corporation, put out a challenge and has essentially partnered with Standard Bank and a couple of other organizations to set up a platform that promotes the activity of women in finance and investment, with the belief that if you have more women in capital allocating roles on the continent, that drives more positive outcomes in terms of capital going into women-led businesses. Mm-hmm. So the goal for this platform is to raise up to $1 billion over the next 10 years that will go to supporting women fund managers on the continent. The idea is also to provide technical assistance to these women fund managers and the incubator as well. So it's coming back to the point of aligning incubators and capital, is to have an incubator that is incubating the fund managers, and then it's part of the fund that will then be investing in those women fund managers and providing them with the required technical assistance. So, I mean, that's something that I'm also very personally very, very excited about, because I do think there is a gap that needs to be filled. And it's something that we look forward to seeing growing over the next couple of years. And there are actually a lot more. So there's the 2X challenge as well, which was started by a lot of the DFIs, and Tracy would know this because the UK government is one of the leaders of the 2X Challenge, which again is focusing on promoting the growth of women-owned and women-led businesses, as well as businesses that support the advancement of women.
Tracy?
Yeah, I mean, I could just add another example, but I think the point that I would say is that it's good that we are seeing the recognition of how to integrate and to build the capacity of women. So, I mean, first-time fund managers generally struggle regardless of gender. And then when you consider why we're not getting, or why we don't have women in these roles, I think that's a really key consideration. I think we've seen some donor money come in to support these initiatives around capacity building, but I think we need to be asking ourselves, like any, I think the STEM projects did this quite well and still continue to do this, is how are we getting women in schools, young women, how are we getting them interested? How are we integrating them into the value chain? And I feel that that conversation still has some way to go. We, even when we're making elective choices around what subjects, around what degrees or qualifications or routes we pursue, I think there's a lot of support needed around that space, which naturally builds the ecosystem. So I would definitely say that there's positive movement, there's been a lot of improvement, but it all seems to be, I think my sense is with the money is that we see one great idea and we have a lot of people follow it, but nobody's thinking about the next part of the value chain. And from everything I've said today, if there's only one message I'd like you to leave with today, is that you cannot do this in isolation. So consistently think about the value chain in relation to who's next to you on the one side and then on the other side. And does your product or your offering or your capability connect with that? And I think gender is as important to think of in those contexts as everything else we've said today.
Rue, you mentioned the fact that were you suggesting that funds are setting up their own incubators as they make their investments?
Oh, what I meant was the African Women Impact Fund, which is what UNECA and Standard Bank are developing, is going to have an incubator piece to it as well. So there will be a piece that's where the fund is allocating capital to women fund managers, but a part of it is around the capacity building and the technical assistance, which is what the incubator is.
Mm-hmm. So how long
out of that, which would be doing all of that.
So what would the mechanics be for that? So the fund makes the investment and then it would be like a special purpose entity set aside as an incubator. And how does that work? How does that get monitored for the duration of the investment cycle?
So I actually can't talk a lot about the fund because then from a FINRA perspective, I would be noted as fund marketing the fund. I'll speak more about the foundation itself, which the foundation is where the incubator piece will be, right? So it's where we'll get, that is attracting donor money and any other type of institutional money. But the purpose of that will really to be to incubate the fund managers and emerging manager program, essentially.
Congratulations on that regulatory catch, Rue. I counsel my clients to do that.
It's the one thing my compliance team was like, make sure you do not.
Yeah. Well, so. we can talk about how to do that in the future without having to worry about it. But that's a phone call we'll have later. There was a question I had here about mechanics. We kind of addressed that question before. What are the, let's talk about the investors in impact investing. We mentioned venture capital funds. We mentioned some private equity. How involved, for example, is private equity across the continent? I know we are homogenizing here, but for the sake of a quick panel discussion, how active is private equity? I know it's different in like Kenya versus South Africa. Versus Ethiopia, for example. I know it's going to be different. But how does private equity do its thing across the continent versus venture capital, direct investments? And then what's the role of, for example, I guess this is a multi-part question, high net worth investors, individual investors in the continent? And then finally, I want to ask a question that I rarely ask in forums like this. A lot of people participating today probably thinking that we're talking about impact investing money coming from outside of the continent. How much impact investing money is coming from inside the continent? And of course, that's country specific too. So that was a mouthful. So who wants to take any part of that?
I'm going to jump on the last part of the question, just probably because I remember it. But to be very honest, I would say that it's hopefully changing, but it is variable and it does change. But I think that there's a couple of dimensions that are worth unpacking. I would see that you've had very prolific ultra high net worths like the Tony Elamelu Foundation. You've had really key players. He's in Nigeria, for those that don't know. And actually, he's Africa-wide, but his roots is Nigerian. But that was a really good example of, I would say, contributing and building ecosystem and contributing holistically. But we are seeing, for example, and this is, again, me in my former life doing some work with the largest South African pension funds, where they are the first ones to acknowledge that they need to be in South African infrastructure, energy, renewable energy plays. So there is definitely, depending on the asset class view that they take, and impact investing is sector agnostic, I believe, as well. But it is dependent on the type of investor, you know, where they play a role and what they're going to do. I would say that the linking it in with the private equity space is you've had private equity been around long enough. You've got some funds. I mean, the Actis funds, which were seeded through originally through the very old CDC and versions thereof, and it's been spun off. They're on iterations of numerous funds. You've got the Helios Group, again, which have done, dominated from being, you know, a one-hit wonder to becoming a very consistent standard contributor, who've almost in some ways helped contribute and rewrite the PE textbook. And then you've got, I think, newer players which are doing great work as well, like DPI. So I think the localization or the homegrown continent content and capital is becoming deeper. But, and I don't want to belabor the challenges, but I do think we have certain regulatory challenges which limit some of the softer, more experimental types of money that would come from ultra high net worths and even, you know, contributions through foundations. I think those are slightly more nuanced areas that still need work. I'll hand it to the other panelists to add or to, you know, disagree.
I totally agree with you, first of all, Tracy. I would add that in the last few years, right, there's been if you look at the numbers, there's been a slight decline in private equity fundraising and an increase in VC towards Africa. So not necessarily fundraising in Africa, but VC investing onto the African continent. And this is, I mean, it's no secret. It's been driven by the rise of technology startups on the continent, whether it's fintech, healthcare. Health tech is another big area that we're seeing investors from the US, actually first-time investors, VC investors coming in to put some bets on the African continent. Agri-tech is another area that you're seeing some investors come in, some VC investors from offshore, as well as the growth of the local VC space in Africa, where you have funds like CRE Ventures. There's TLCOM that's based in Kenya and does some work in a couple of the markets on the African continent. And then the other piece I would mention, speaking of a US crowd, is we've been doing some work, and I see Lee Stevens, one of our partners on the line, actually with BNY Mellon, but we've been doing some work with MEDA, which is part of the USAID, with the US government, which is centered on trying to promote US institutional investment into Africa. So when you talk of funds like DPI, just as an example that Tracy mentioned earlier, those are some of the funds that have been receiving money from some of the US and institutional investors that are starting to increase their allocations to Africa. And two reasons are driving that. There are a couple, but I'll mention two. One is, you know, investors are looking for yield from the US. And then the other piece is the ESG impact story, coming back to the conversation we're having right now. Africa lends itself to that dynamic and being able to, I don't want to use the word check the box, but being able to fulfill that objective for the funds. So I hope to see more institutional investors from the US into Africa, partnering with, you know, as Tracy was mentioning, the South African pension funds and pension funds from Uganda, all the markets.
It's just worthwhile Sorry, Rue, just to add that actual venture that you're talking about with the US pension funds coming in to work with is actually working with, they started off with Kenyan pension funds. So mm-hmm. NIDA actually has managed to group the Kenyans and solidify the Kenyan, which is a very fragmented space for those that don't know. So I think that's really important. And then they've looked at the different model in South Africa where they've used, obviously it's a much bigger, concentrated group of funding, where they've worked with the 12 biggest pension funds to create a collegiate group of what they call the Asset Owners Forum. So they would arguably be looking both at international and local institutional monies to work and obviously figure out what the respective roles are in those investment infrastructure investment plays.
Okay. And part of the reason, right, Tracy, for the interaction with, say, the Kenyan asset owners and the South African, is to build that connectivity amongst asset owners from the US and those in Africa. Because coming back again to a point of having partners on the ground who know how to invest in the opportunities on the continent, this is another area where this is being facilitated to achieve that outcome.
The UK is actually doing the same, called the Mobilis program, where they're taking a slightly more top-down approach, where they're trying to figure out what the right products will be. And theirs is really around things like how do we create more products that have better price mechanisms, that we can deal with data asymmetry issues. So there's the Mobilis program, but it's looking at its UK institutional money and it's supported by the UK government. So everybody is pretty much trying to say, I would say, looking at how do they get that bit of yield uplift that they want, managed, of course. Those of you that know institutionals know that they don't take risk easily and that they are very prescriptive in their process. So I think fitting that risk in with the desire for yield is still very much a process that has to happen. But the interest and the desire, I would say, is definitely there based on these programs that we've been talking about. Sorry, I know Rue and I have dominated this, so I'll hand it back to you, David.
That is bad.
No, that's fine. So in the interest of time, just one quick question, and this is really calls for a comprehensive answer. This has to do with measurement of impact. So there are various metrics for measuring impact. What's the latest in a quick response? What's the latest on measurement, controversies around measurement, et cetera? Any one of you?
My comments typically going to come with my chemical engineering hat on and through what the iChemie does in terms of supporting SDG, sustainable development goals through the UN. Mm-hmm. And they have a good framework and metrics of what those numbers look like in terms of achieving those and going towards those success parameters looks like. And that could be rolled over and involved to create an impact measurement. But ultimately, my opinion is that being very specific with measurement, it has to be easy to replicate and easy to, you know, wherever you are in the world, and easy to understand. And also easy to get the information that creates that metric. Mm-hmm. And that's been a challenge, you know, from the carbon footprint stuff and just measuring those, how much CO2 has been offset. For example, that alone is problematic and different across the world. So I don't think I'm answering your question directly, but I think it's a problem. But I think there's a lot of progress towards figuring that out globally. And once that's done, that's going to make it a lot easier for comparability, which is important.
Yeah, the issue with measuring carbon reduction is certainly not limited to the impact investing space. It's a much larger problem. And people are playing all kinds of games around the world. So certainly not an African issue. Let me just thank you I want to get back to a couple of questions before we wrap it up. So I don't want to leave people hanging. One of the questions is, has there been an increased focus in healthcare impact investing on the continent since the start of the pandemic? And you kind of touched on this a bit. So Tracy's nodding her head. So go ahead, Tracy.
Well, I'm the sector director for financial and professional services, but my colleague, he looks after healthcare. And if you look at the gains made in a loan in supporting and overcoming market access barriers, which we count as wins, that has been the biggest change. And I think that is, if you have to look for the positive linked to COVID, is we've seen, not purely regulatory, but we've seen numerous changes around the value chain around healthcare, which have shown more investment on a very continent level. So I would say that that's, and we're seeing, again, I speak from the perspective of the British corporates and British taxpayers, but we're seeing a lot more initiative and momentum to want to look for opportunity and support problems on the continent. So I think definitely it's been one of the, probably what was previously a very important, but you didn't have people queuing up. I think it's definitely changed. It's a huge observation.
So finally, because we're at 12:56, a question comes in, there's two parts, but I'm going to give one part in the interest of time. How do you maintain oversight of use of funds in areas that are notorious for fund leakage? That sounds like an integrity enterprise risk question. So anyone want to take that one?
My suggestion would be, I guess each market is different in making any investment, doing your DD. At the end of the day, right, it's ensuring that you're partnering with players on the ground that have a long track record, know and understand the market, and can help you, if there are, minimize some of those risks related to the leakage conversation. But that applies to any investment. The DD aspect, and I can't stress enough partnering with reputable players who've been doing this for a while and really understand the market.
Well, have some independent researchers as well to help you out. Like we were talking earlier about certain countries for research. Can I just add like Helios with B Corp, where there's a high transparency. That's a good leading the path of doing that well. A good reference point is reading Abraj, The Key Man. Sorry, I'm not connected to the book. That was a good example of a big impact investment-driven narrative that didn't go well and wasn't trusted. And I think there's a lot that can be learned from what happened with Abraj.
Okay, the book was Key Man, was it?
Yeah, The Key Man.
Okay, so on that note, the powers that be at New York Alt Roundtable are trying to tell me that we're running out of time. So I'm going to turn it back over to BJ at this point. Thank the panelists, Tawana, Rue, and Tracy for a great discussion. Thanks a lot.
And thank you, David. Echo that. Thank you, David, Tawana, Rue, and Tracy. That was quite enlightening. What I'd also mention is this was our first investment forum on Africa. It won't be our last. Certainly the participation by the audience, I think, reflects the need for more of these. And what I would suggest to the audience, first, I thank everyone for joining, but I would suggest on the holding screen here, you see the contact information for each of the speakers. If you have questions that come up or that were not answered in today's panel, feel free to reach out separately. As they said, they're each experts in different areas. So speak to them.